Now, we have a speaker, someone who's going to talk to us about crunch time, which is basically the global game jam, and then smeared over a couple of months, you know? It's like hell on earth, but most of you probably know crunch time. But here to tell you more about his own experience, JP van Seventer. Welcome there, Mr. Interview.
Thank you. So just a quick check here. How many of you played Redcat growing up? Yes! Woo! Thank you. I needed that. So I'm going to talk about crunch time in the real game world. As some of you know, I actually used to build games. And I started in 98 building games. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about crunch time. I'm going to tell you about my first crunch time and my last crunch time as a developer. And then maybe you'll see some parallels. You'll also see some pictures of other people you may know. Let's proceed. Do I just hit this? There you go. Thank you. So I'll tell you a crunch time for the good reason and one for a bad reason. Some of the stuff I do, whatever. So my background is industrial design. I studied in Design Academy Eindhoven, and I learned 3D modeling in Blender in 98. Yes! Before that, I studied mechanical engineering, which I did not finish, but I did finish almost all the math. So I tried to make chairs based on the mathematical formulas that I used to actually make. And I loved 3D. 3D is actually the reason I got into the game industry. So with that knowledge, I was one of the few people who knew how to use Blender and 3D Max 1.0. Yes, I know, I'm an old guy. And I made graphics for the first games at Davilex. People, Davilex. Yes. Yes. I admit it. I know what you're thinking. So this is my career. I started as an artist. I moved through the circle of design towards the administration and business. And now I'm on the outside, because I don't build games anymore. I help other people build games. So, yes, here we are. It's out. I worked for Davilex. I'm sorry. Oh, yeah. Oh! So, never mind. Go back. The Amsterdam t-shirt. That did it. Yes. So, my first job as an artist. Yep, that's me right there. With the purple office color, because that was the color of Davilex. Once the biggest studio in the Netherlands, over 70 people, building 3 games simultaneously with a whole dedicated engine and tools team. Amazing. There. I put this slide in for the NHTV people, because who is out there looking at us? Jaco! Yes! Jaco. Jaco founded the technical part of the NHTVs. So, these guys, and if you guys know these, anybody here at the HQU ever had lessons from Marcel Dulong? Yes. And here on the right is Mike. Mike was an intern at the time. I'll get back to him in a minute. And this guy in the middle, actually, now, after Davilex folded, is working for Nixus. He works on Lara Croft and all the other stuff in Utrecht. So crunch time for the bad reason. My first job. I had no idea what games building was about. I know how to play them, but I didn't know anything about it. So I started at the Redcat team. If you saw the 3D portfolio I was admitted with, I would be very embarrassed, and so would you. But I got a job. I first worked on these characters. I did animations on them. Then I worked on Megapack 2 and 3. Yes. Anybody recognize these levels? I built them. I built that one. I built this whole level. This is, of course, you never saw it this way, but this is how I built it. Now, here's the actual reason for the bad crunch time. I had to build it in this really archaic tool, the ISO editor. And the problem with this is I could not play any of the levels. So I could build them. But the programmer running the project did not think it was important that I could play them until like maybe really later in the process. So I built, no, I didn't build 30 levels. I built 65 levels without ever playing them. And then 3 weeks or 2 weeks before the deadline, he thought it would be a good idea if I could start playing them. So I played 65 levels in 2 weeks by myself, because I built these all by myself. So I only knew how to play them, to make sure that you could finish them. Because, you know, if there was a jump somewhere that was too far, you may not have been able to play the game. And we were shipping in 2 weeks. I kid you not. They were going to be burned on CD in 2 weeks. So anybody ever recognize this level? Anybody? It's the Chinese wall. There's actually a secret passage right there. So now you know. So that was crunch time for the bad reason. And very helpful colleagues. Nothing has changed, guys. This happened in the 90s as well. So, crunch time lessons. Never trust a programmer. Do you know when a programmer says he can't do it, it usually means they don't think it's important? Remember that one. When you're a shy little new employer at a games company and a programmer says they can't, try again. Don't be too polite. Pipeline is everything. I learned that too. Iterations are the holy grail, really. You guys have it easy with all your fancy tools, trust me. Then Amsterdam, I built some of that. Maybe some of you played this awesome game. Then I took pictures in Berlin for the German version. So this is Art Bonewald here on the right. Some of you may know him. We went on a photo shoot together. And then Night Rider was the last game I worked on as a level designer. Anybody play this brilliant game? Thank you. Awesome. I will be handing out signatures afterwards. Then I was sick of Davilex. I trust you. I worked there for 4 years. And some things just didn't change and didn't get better. So I moved to Maui for 3 months. Did windsurfing because that was really a lost child dream. I actually photographed my childhood hero, Robbie Nash. Anybody here played any windsurfers? Yes. See all the old guys raising their hands. Yeah. And this is me. I tried to look like Niels het Hoofd. Again, I met a lot of cool people, great people, and I realized that surfing was not going to be my rest of my life, and I was thinking about it and smoking a lot of cigars, and after 3 months, I went back and I changed career to the mobile industry, mobile games, and I started teaching at THQ. In 2003, these are some of the games I worked on. Some of you may recognize it. Again, of course, there's Jaco again. Jaco and I built this together. So he may have showed you this. It's the first 3D rendered game on the Nokia, which is actually not supposed to render 3D. Then I met this guy through Jeroen van Maastricht. He's from Woodend Communicatiebureau, and he said, why don't you start a studio? Because I already have a project. I already have the money. All you have to do is build a team. Oh, that sounds good. So I helped co-found a studio. The only catch was, and actually this is my career as a producer manager, the only catch was a pony game for girls. So four guys, me of course, I call my old colleagues, three friends from Davilex, and we built this beautiful game, but we didn't know anything about horseback riding, so there we are. We're taking lessons. So we took lessons in the Hollandse Manege, which was actually the first level we built was modeled after the Hollandse Manege. This is in Amsterdam, right on the Overtoom. I actually was thrown off the horse the third time. So I had to, I don't know, they had this rule that you had to buy cake for if you were thrown off. So that worked, but I survived. And that was it. Then this company was funded by investors, private investors. So when you're lucky, sometimes you get to drive their Porsche home after a good dinner the night before. But that enabled us to build a big team. We went from 4 to about 30 guys and girls in about 2.5 years. This is at the Damrak. This is where we were. And this is, of course, one of the team outings, also funded by the private investors. And then crunch time, for the good reason. So we had this beautiful game. It looked really good. And it looked really beautiful and romantic, awesome. And then these guys said, you guys sell it fast, because we want our money back. So me and Martin Brandt, some of you may know him, we went to San Francisco and to Los Angeles to sell this game in 2006. And there we met at the E3. We pitched to Nintendo, and the guy that we're pitching to, Tom Prada, said, let me go get somebody. And all of a sudden he shows up with Mr. Miyamoto and his translator, which is the most awesome thing, to pitch your game to Mr. Miyamoto himself. And he loved it. He loved it. And why did he love it? Because you had this level where you actually cared for the horse. And of course, this was Nintendo's time, guys. And girls, think he loved it. He really thought it was cool. But the Wii was come out in 2007. It was going to be launched before Christmas. And we needed content. But we needed to sell the game. And Nintendo was so busy getting that launch ready that they kept saying, wait, wait, wait. And we didn't have time. The investors didn't have time. We didn't have time. So Atari made us a deal to do the game, put it out, and beat Ubisoft, which also was in the market for horseback riding games. And so we were going to be either the only Wii game with horseback riding or the second one. Either way, we had one submission. We had to convert a PC engine, the reality engine, to a Wii, which I don't know much about programming, but I know that's pretty much ridiculous. Basically, they explained it to me is you have a house, you take out all the bricks, you leave the mortar, and then you put all the other bricks in. That much work it was. And that was, but this was the really foundation of our studio. The money that we made with this deal paid for most of the studio and most of the time that we spend in it. And really, the credit goes to these guys here, especially the techies. Some of you may recognize Niels here and Mike. These guys worked their butts off and built a whole Wii engine in 6 months. And that's crunch time. But this was a good crunch time because afterwards we produced two games, PC games for Windows and a Wii, the first Wii game in the Netherlands. So that was a good crunch time. We took it. We took the money. We went for it. After that, W Games became Vanguard Studios when it went together with Karami. And what I learned is programmers are awesome. And sometimes you got to run with the money. Miyamoto is a very cool person. He's a very humble man. I was really privileged to meet him. And running a big game studio is quite complicated. So you guys have it extremely easy with your schools and great tools. So what you guys made in 48 hours would not have been possible in 98, trust me. We would have made 5 iterations the whole weekend. You guys made at least 30. So imagine the time you guys are living in, I'm jealous of. I wish I had learned Unity and GameMaker in school right now. And I'm still, when my kids are going to get a little older and I have a little more time, I still want to learn these tools. But this is a great time to be a game developer. So, Dutch Game Garden, I'm actually not making games, I'm helping you make games and I'm helping you build companies. So if you need help from me or my colleagues, then contact us. If you're thinking of founding your own company, go for it and we'll help you.